Hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing the joints in the ankle region, which will actually involve more than just the ankle joint. Our first goal will be to actually locate these, so we're going to identify the articulating bones, then of course determine the actions or movements possible at these joints. We'll discuss a few ligaments, certainly not all of them, and of course discuss clinical considerations throughout as appropriate. So as mentioned, when discussing the joints in this region, there are certainly more than just the ankle joint, more properly called the talocrural joint, which you can see here outlined in this dashed blue. Although the ankle joint is the largest in this region and most prominent. But just superior to the ankle joint, there will be the inferior tibiofibular joint. And distal to the ankle joint, we will have intertarsal joints, which are covered up here by ligaments and fascia, two of which we're going to discuss, which are the subtalar and the transverse tarsal joints. We will start with the most proximal of these joints, which is the inferior tibiofibular joint. And here it's outlined, it could even be extended a little bit further down here. It's outlined in this dashed line. And the name of the joint is very descriptive. It is going to be the most inferior of the three tibiofibular joints. And there's a similar pattern to what we had in the forearm between the radius and the ulna. Recall that there were three joints there. You had one kind of proximal or superior, one interosseous membrane connecting the bodies or shafts, and then one inferior or distal joint. And that's exactly what you have between the tibia and the fibula. The largest difference between the forearm and the leg is the degree of movement occurring. Where there was pronation and supination in the forearm, there's very little movement allowed at the tibiofibular joints. However, the integrity of the inferior tibiofibular joint is essential in the stability of that ankle joint, which is just distal, it's like right here. Really, this joint will kind of serve to keep the lateral malleolus, which is this region right here of the fibula, firmly against the lateral surface of the talus or the talus. You'll hear it either way. Damage to the ligaments associated with the inferior tibiofibular joint, like this one, yellow one here, which for fun, but not for memorization, is called the anterior tibiofibular ligament. Or even the distal portions of the interosseous membrane, which is going to kind of extend down into this region. If you have some type of stretching or tearing associated with these, this is often referred to as a high ankle sprain. Now moving to the big one, the true ankle joint or the talocrural joint. This is formed by the distal tibia mainly when we're talking about the more proximal bones. You can see it forming this roof-like portion here, as well as the distal fibula articulating with the superior portion of the talus or the talus, which is your most superior tarsal bone. The medial malleolus of the tibia and the lateral malleolus of the fibula, or the malleolus, you'll hear it either way, will flank the joint and really serve to grip the talus tightly to best allow for the hinge motions at this joint. And speaking of hinge motions, this occurs because this is a hinge joint, with the major actions being plantar flexion and dorsiflexion. Dorsiflexion I always conceptualize as digging in one's heels, kind of into the ground, with the toes pointing up, or the forefoot pointing up. Whereas plantar flexion is what occurs when you stand on your toes or the ball of your foot, so the heel is going to be moved superiorly and the toes kind of more inferiorly. Oftentimes, people have a difficult time conceptualizing this joint as a hinge joint because it very, very often occurs with other actions in the foot region as well, such as inversion and eversion, and even a little bit of wobbling, which, yes, is a scientific term there, which can happen in plantar flexion. But it's really this hinge motion, this plantar flexion and dorsiflexion, that most characteristically occurs at the ankle joint. Now let's talk a little about the ligaments associated with the ankle joint. Similar to other hinge joints, there are ligaments on the medial side and the lateral side, which in essence are called collateral ligaments. The difference here is the collateral ligaments of the ankle joint are not organized as one solid structure, but instead an amalgamation of smaller ligaments. Additionally, while supporting and promoting the hinge movements that occur at the ankle joint, these ligaments also serve to stabilize during some foot motions, particularly inversion and eversion. So starting on the medial side, which is this image here, we have the medial or the deltoid ligaments, which are composed of four parts. We're not going to have you memorize these, but I do want you to understand that they all proximally attach to the medial malleolus or malleus of the tibia, and their fibers intermingle, forming this really robust protection in this medial area. So these medial ligaments or deltoid ligaments are noticeably stronger than their lateral counterparts, and these stabilize during eversion. This is eversion here. The sole of the foot is going to move more laterally, and if you evert and then invert your foot, moving the sole of the foot more medially, you will notice you have a greater range of motion in inversion than you do with eversion. So this partly is due to the fact that those medial or deltoid ligaments are so robust, so you only have so much range of motion in terms of eversion. On the lateral side, you have the aptly named lateral ligaments, of which there are three, anterior talofibular, calcaneofibular, and you cannot see the posterior talofibular ligament in this illustration. It'd be back here. These all have attachment on the lateral malleolus of the fibula, but as you can see here, they don't interweave together, such as what you had up here with the medial ligaments. So due to this and other reasons, they are relatively weaker than their medial counterparts and will allow a greater range of motion in inversion of the foot, for which it provides stabilization during that movement. One of the three of these ligaments is the most prone to injury, such as sprains or even complete tears, and this would be the anterior talofibular ligament, which I just outlined, or the ATFL, which you can see right here between the fibula and the talus or the talus, so the most commonly injured of the ligaments. So let's take a moment and consider ankle sprains. And this is the most common injury to the ankle region and is also one of the most common musculoskeletal injuries. This includes damage to the ligaments in this region of the ankle, which can range widely in severity from overly stretched to completely torn, but it most commonly occurs in the lateral ligaments with an over inversion, so too much inversion occurring when the foot is kind of planted down or plantar flexed. So when the foot is kind of stuck down in plantar flexion, and then you have too much inversion occurring, the ankle just kind of rolls. In fact, you often hear this referred to as a rolled ankle. Again, due to the mechanism of the injury, it is those lateral ligaments that are most commonly damaged, in particular that ATFL or the anterior talofibular ligament. Moving distally, we get to all the tarsal bones, and since there are seven tarsal bones, this means there are numerous intertarsal joints, or joints between the tarsal bones, but we're going to focus on two, the subtalar and the transverse tarsal, mainly due to the fact that they are the major players in those actions we keep bringing up, inversion and eversion. Again, inversion is bringing the sole of the foot or the plantar surface more medially, or pulling that medial surface of the foot more superiorly, whereas eversion is bringing the sole of the foot more laterally, pulling that lateral surface of the foot more superiorly. In terms of basic locations of these joints, the subtalar joint is located between the talus or the talus and your heel bone or your calcaneus, meaning the joint is inferior to the talus. It is at this joint that the majority of the mobility occurs for inversion and eversion. The transverse tarsal joint is a bit more complicated, as this is a complex joint formed by two separate intertarsal joints, but they're located kind of on the same plane, as you can see here, indicated by this dashed line. So between the talus and the navicular, and between the calcaneus down here and calcaneus and the cuboid right here. Don't worry so much about memorizing the navicular, the cuboid, or these specific names of these joints. I just wanted to kind of put these here to kind of better describe. But I do want you to understand that it's kind of just distal to that talus-calcaneus complex. So right here before you get to the rest of the tarsal bones. While not the primary joint for inversion and eversion, it certainly will augment these motions. So you commonly see, including in our resources, that inversion and eversion occur at both the subtalar and transverse tarsal joints. All right, excellent. Thanks for sticking with me to talk about this important region of anatomy, and particularly in terms of joints. Please take time to review these major points outlined in the summary slide. And as always, if you have any questions, please reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.